joy and pleasure to be in his house, to be in his presence, and to be in your presence this morning. I don't know if you ever noticed on the front part of your LSB, I don't know if you just want to take that out for a moment, just like the front panel. See that front panel? There are prayers. Prayers on entering the church, prayers before worship, and prayers after worship. You know, we are the Father's children, and we enter into his house, and he desires to keep us in safety. So while we're following the guidelines and doing things in that nature, might we also just call to vigilance in prayer? You know, just to be conscious of praying before we enter, before worship and after worship, that everyone who gathers in this place might enjoy the safety of the Lord and to worship in his presence. So I just wanted to make you aware of that. With that, I want to share our worship theme for this morning. It reads as follows: acknowledging Jesus as the Christ is central to our confession of faith as individual Christians and vital in our worship as the gathered people of God. In our use of that divine title, we echo the words of the angel who spoke to the shepherds in the field outside of Bethlehem with the gospel message: for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. We are blessed in knowing that Jesus the Christ is not only God in person, in human form, but that he is God for us. St. Patrick poetically spoke his confession with these words: Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, and Christ in me. Isn't that beautiful? Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me. As we confess Jesus as Christ this day, we are joining with saints and angels, as well as with sisters and brothers that surround us gathered for worship. And with that, we worship. God bless you.
Thank you.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are forgiven.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, that receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And we reflect. And we pray together. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Old Testament lesson is from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 51, verses 1 to 6. The Lord says, "Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were cut and the quarry from which you were hewn. Look to Abraham your father and to Sarah who gave you birth. When I called him, he was only one man, and I blessed him and made him many. The Lord will surely comfort Zion and will look with compassion on all her ruins. He will make her deserts like Eden, her wastelands like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the sound of singing. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. Instruction will go out from me. My justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way, and my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm. Lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look at the earth beneath. The heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and its inhabitants die like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My righteousness will never fail." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To him be the glory forever. Amen. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your reasonable service. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. And this is the word of the Lord. We stand for the Alleluia. Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked, who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. So I have here an old bank card, an old debit card founded behind some seats. You know what happens to old cards. They're supposed to come up, and sometimes they end up behind seats and what have you. Now imagine if I just like put this in my wallet and I went into a store, maybe my Stop and Shop or the ShopRite, and I handed them this card upon making my purchase of groceries. What would happen? Yeah, exactly. You are denied, you are rejected, not approved. In fact, it would be very embarrassing. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation like that, or if you've seen others, you know, you start fumbling, you start saying, well, I know my card is good, I know I have money, and you start doing all these things, but it ends up looking like a mess until you realize, oh, wait a minute, this is my old card. Well, the reason is, of course, when we give these things to purchase items, really what stands behind it is our word, right? It's our word, it's our own personal credibility, it's our faith and full credit that yes, my word is good and my money is good and you can take it to the bank. That's what stands behind our use of all of these things, whether it be a paper check or a card or what have you, right? Our credit is good. Well, in our gospel text, God wants us to know that his word is good. Peter confessed that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And how was that revealed to Peter? God's word inspiring him to speak that word concerning Christ. In other words, you could take it to the bank. You could take it to the bank of God. And so powerful is that word that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus says, I'm going to build my church on that rock. Remember those old commercials, build your future on a rock? We can build our future, we can build our present, we can build our lives on the rock, who is Jesus Christ. And that, brothers and sisters, you can take to the bank. Amen?
Amen.
Protect us and guard us and fill us with your healing light and fill us now with your Holy Spirit. We pray it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So grace and mercy and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This morning I want to share with you from the topic of what to do, what to do. What to do. It's kind of one of those things we say when we're faced with a big problem or some insurmountable conundrum. We kind of throw our hands in the proverbial air and we just kind of wonder what to do, what to do. I don't know, maybe some of you are feeling that way this morning in light of the constant developments in our world. What to do, what to do? Well, in our epistle lesson, Paul is faced with a major conundrum himself, a major problem. And you can see that as he gets to the end of his discourse in Romans 11, particularly in verse 33, he says, oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Verse 36, and from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. And in my Bible, that has a heading, doxology. And doxology is a song of praise. But if you're really reading what it is Paul is describing, it doesn't really come off as a song of praise. Really what it sounds like is a statement of resignation. Resignation. What to do? What to do? I might call it, to fuse those two things together, a doxological resignation. He is resigning himself on the mighty magnificence of the living God, because God is the only one who has an answer to his problem and his conundrum. So he says, from him and through him and for him are all things. God is the whole show, so to speak, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending. He's the only one I can go to with my problem anyhow. It sounds more like a doxological resignation. But what is it that's on Paul's heart? What weighs upon him? What's causing this resignation? Well, if you go back a little bit in the text, Romans 11, verse 25, he says to the people, I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. Now, this word mystery is what we find in 1 Corinthians 15, mystery concerning the resurrection of God's people at the end of time. But Paul is saying it is another mystery, a mystery concerning this faith. And this is it. He says, Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the fullness of the number of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved. Once more, we find Paul wrestling with the conundrum of why is it his own people, the Jewish people, have rejected the faith of Jesus Christ. So in his way of understanding it, he calls it a mystery, and he says Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the fullness of the number of Gentiles has come in. This is his way of understanding that his own people have rejected the gospel of Jesus, and it must be as they are hardened that there's a softening in the heart of the Gentiles and they are receiving the message. Imagine how amazing this could be to Paul. Paul, a Jewish man, preaching a Christ, a Jewish Messiah. I mean, remember Peter, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That was a revelation spoken from Jewish lips to Jewish people concerning the living God, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. This was a Jewish affair. And how is it that Paul's own people, he's wrestling inside, he's troubled inside, he has a conundrum, he's grieved. He said, why is it that they have rejected this message of life? It must be that they are hardened for a time until the full number of non-Jewish persons, you, me, can come into the kingdom. But this is a mystery. So Paul finds himself in a situation, what to do, what to do. Then he uses an analogy, backing up further in this chapter, he uses an analogy of the olive tree. He likens Israel, as the prophets of old, to the idea of a beautiful, cultivated olive tree. God's own planting with God's own hands, who pruned it in love and care in a meticulous way to produce what God wanted to produce, a beautiful olive tree. But then he speaks to us Gentiles, and he says, I really want you to get this reality, and I believe he wants us to get this reality now. Verses 17, it says, if some of the branches have been broken off, and you, though a wild olive, should have been grafted in among the others, and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive root, notice what we are likened to? Wild olive branches, us non-Jewish folk. Wild olive branches that have been grafted in to God's beautiful cultivated olive tree. And now we receive of the sap, the energy and power and rootedness of God. Verse 18, do not consider yourself to be superior to those other branches. If you do, consider this, you do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches were broken off so that I could be grafted in. Paul says, granted. But they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but tremble. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Whoa, Paul. Very powerful words. Essentially, what he's saying is that Israel, the people Israel, that community of faith, is the root of the olive tree, God's beautiful cultivated tree that he had been planting for ages. And that we are the wild olive branches that have been grafted into this Jewish tree by faith in Jesus Christ. And as such, the branches are supported by the root. not the root by the branches. As such, we ought never to be arrogant about this faith that we have in Jesus Christ, that we have been brought into the cultivated, beautiful tree of the Lord. We have been made his family in holy baptism. We share in the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. All these things betoken the reality that we are now part of God's family. And Paul is reminding us non-Jewish Christians that we ought never to be arrogant about that. We ought never to be complacent about that. We ought never to take those things for granted. We ought never to take this for granted, that we gather in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that we've been washed clean, and yes, we partake of the body and blood of his Son. And all these things, Paul's saying, is given to you of love, just out of love, just sheer grace, just sheer blessing that God's given. We ought never to be arrogant. And we ought never to take these things for granted. Paul continues in verse 22. Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God. Sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided you continue in that kindness. So Paul is revealing God not as some saccharine savior full of sugar and spice and everything nice, but a God of law and a God of gospel, a God of sternness and a God of kindness. You ever just reread the Old Testament, you see that God can be quite stern sometimes in making clear who he is and what he expects. And the people of ancient Israel, they rejected the message of the gospel, so God in his sternness allowed them to fall. But yet he's given us kindness. Us non-Jewish Christians, we receive the kindness of God. We didn't labor through all of that time and space to produce the Messiah. That came from the Jewish people. But we receive the kindness of the Lord. And in fact, Jesus is the kindness of God. Jesus Christ in his person is the kindness of God. And we have received that. This is a dramatic statement of Paul of both law and gospel, our time-tested Lutheran hermeneutic existing in the dynamic relation, the sternness and kindness of God. And it is an admonition for us to continue in God's kindness. Continue in Jesus. You know, the vine, the branches, stay connected to the vine, especially during times like these. Stay connected to the kindness of God because we don't want to experience his sternness. Otherwise, Paul says, you also will be cut off. Wow, Paul. Sometimes the Bible can be quite stern, can it not? And what Paul is advising us, non-Jewish Christians, again, don't take it for granted. Don't get self-satisfied. We got to watch out for our labels, too. I mean, I'm proud to be Lutheran, but that's not what this is about. Others say, well, I'm a Baptist, I'm a Methodist, I'm a Catholic, and we have all our reasons to boast. But I think Paul is saying to us there was no greater boast than saying I'm Jewish. And if God cut them off of unbelief, what about us? Are we better? God calls them the apple of his eye. In fact, we have many ministries, even in the Lutheran Church, apple of his eye ministry towards the Jewish people. And do we claim somehow some kind of superiority? No, if we don't continue in the kindness of the Lord, we too can be cut off. And this is what brings Paul back to his doxology of resignation. He says, oh, the depth of the riches of wisdom and the knowledge of God, how unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. In other words, God can't be tracked. His paths are in the heavens, his paths are in the sea, and God cannot be tracked down unless he wants to be found. Who has known the mind of the Lord, and who has been his counselor? Who was ever given to God that God should repay them? God is magnificent. God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. We might be finding ourselves now in a conundrum, maybe like Paul's. We can't understand everything that's happening. What to do, what to do. COVID-19 alerts, further unrest and rioting in our nation. Some cities, not days, not weeks, but months. Lawlessness, seems to abound. The love of many is growing cold. Our populace, our society, our politics are incredibly polarized. And I will say it right now, God help us, whoever wins this election, because I wonder if we can heal back after whichever side wins, because we're so polarized. Lord, have mercy on our nation. What to do, what to do? Maybe we find ourselves like Job. Job, of course, was thrown into the deep end. And Job, in the midst of his struggle, said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. You see, when you really think about it, what Paul is doing here, he's resigning himself on God because he recognizes that God is the only one who can solve the conundrum, because maybe the conundrum itself is posed by God. It's the mystery of why his own Jewish people, their hearts were hardened, and the softening of the Gentiles so they can come in. That's in God's mystery. That's in God's providence. We can't wrap our minds around that. We're the beneficiaries of it, but we can't wrap our minds around it. Paul resigns himself on God. He says, I can't figure that one out. So the only one who can solve my problem is the only one I perceive as the source of my problem. Wow. That's God. He resigned himself on God. You see, and that word, I think, chafes on us as Americans. We're proud Americans. We believe we can do anything. Put our minds to it. We can go to the moon. We can go to Mars. We can solve any problem. The idea of resigning on anything sounds like quitting. Sounds like we're giving up. And that's just not part of our national mythology, who we are, right? It's almost like we say, you know, we can solve our own problems, and God, if we need to phone you up, we will. That's kind of how we live our lives sometimes. We can solve our issues, but if it gets too crazy, then we'll rely on your God. And Paul's saying no. Paul is saying, no, I resign myself on God. In fact, I throw myself upon God because God has thrown me into the situation, and I throw myself back on God. God, from you, through you, and for you are all things. To you be the glory. I resign myself upon you. Maybe we need to adopt that attitude in the church. Maybe we need to lead the way. God, we resign ourselves on you. We can't solve our problems. We can't solve our national problems. We can't solve the problems in our own community. We can't solve the problems in our own church. And you're not going to be the last resort. You're going to be the first resort. You're going to be every resort. We are going to follow, and we're going to throw ourselves upon you. That's what to do. So Paul picks up in chapter 12. He says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, the mercy extended to you non-Jewish Christians by grafting you in, wild olive branches that you are, into the tree, not being arrogant, having humility, I urge you, I beg of you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. The Lord Christ has been sacrificed for you. We ought to present our bodies, our living bodies, as sacrifices, little lambs of sacrifice on the altar of the living God, holy and pleasing to God. This is your logical service. That word in the Greek is logical. Logical, it's reasonable. In fact, we might even call it sane. The sanest thing you can do in your life is trust in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, the Rock of Ages, to base and found your life upon him, to give your entire being, your money, your business, your stuff, everything that pertains to you, to give it over to Jesus Christ, to give it over to God, to resign yourself on him, because he is our only hope. And while you're at it, Paul says, do not conform yourself to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, don't let your mind get drawn into the way and course and flavor of this world. Don't let your mind get so politicized and so jaded and so cynical. Don't let your mind get drawn into all of the conspiracy theories that are flying around in our culture.
this thing is happening because of that. And once that happens, you should see this. And all these people prognosticating and speculating. God is saying, my people, my Christians, don't be conformed to the course of this world, but show yourselves as people that have built your future on the rock. People that believe in Jesus Christ, have resigned themselves to Jesus Christ, and follow him no matter what. And in that way, you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will. Now's the time. What to do? What to do? Build your future on Jesus Christ. Build your present on Jesus Christ, and let this world know through your words and deeds that your life is founded on Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please stand and make our confession of the Apostles. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits.
people of God may pursue righteousness with peace and joy in their hearts, and for all pastors in their ministry of word and sacrament, and for all vocations to the ministry, that the lives of God's people may redound to his praise and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our President, Donald J. Trump, Congress, Governor Ned Lamont, and all civic leaders in their pursuit of peace and unity, for all judges and magistrates in their pursuit of justice with mercy, and for those who protect us from violence and preserve order here and everywhere, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all noble professions and for the flourishing of the arts and music, for favorable weather and the fruits of the earth, and for those unemployed, the poor, the homeless, the hungry, and all people in need, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all families and children, single adults and youth, for those who teach and those who learn, that they may advance in wisdom and grace, and for the catechumens and those who teach the faith to them, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For victims of disaster, and for those stricken by illness or infirmity, for the aged and infirm, as well as those in nursing homes and assisted living facilities, for those who grieve the loss of those who they love, and for those who meet, Lord, have mercy, with sudden death. And especially for those who have requested our prayers, Lord, we lift up to you Pastor John Welke. We understand that in the next few days he's going in for spinal surgery. Lord, we pray your mercies and your blessing and your healing upon him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for his wife, Susie, who we also understand will be going in for heart surgery after her husband. And God, we just pray that you would bless her, that you would heal her, and that you would grant her your comfort in this difficult time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we want to pray with Ellen for a friend of Bob Gerlach, who was severely injured, Lord have mercy, in a robbery. body and blood of Christ, and for our growth in grace, that we may attain to the full stature of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Be merciful to us, O Lord, and hear our prayers. Grant to us the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may be led in all truth and be steadfast in the confession of Christ, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends in Christ, I urge you to lift up your hearts to God and pray with me as Christ our Lord has taught us and freely promised to hear us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Lord our God, for you have called us as your people and have shown us your kindness. Confident of your love and assured of your mercy, we come before you, asking that we receive your blessings with heartfelt thanksgiving. Pour out upon us the gift of your Holy Spirit, and grant that we receive the body and blood of our Lord as a guarantee of our salvation and a foretaste of the feast to come in your eternal kingdom. Together with angels and archangels, and with all who rejoice in the courts of heaven, we praise your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, this do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in the Lord's peace. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you.